In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
All writers are prone to becoming so attached to our characters and stories that we struggle to see why a passage may not be working. It takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our writing to full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable writers to develop and grow, shaping stories into masterpieces that can stand the test of time. Editing services are provided for all genres and all age categories. Services range from critiques of the short story through to the line edits of the full-length novel and copy editing for those preparing for publication. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your website, as well as help with those book blurbs and promotional material. We won't abandon you to the masses. We want to celebrate with you and your successes. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services and prices, visit us at blackwolfeditorial.com.
Individuals and businesses with tax problems, listen carefully. Do you feel like you're losing control over your finances? If you owe over $10,000 in back taxes or have unfiled tax returns, we can help you take back control. The IRS is the largest and most aggressive collection agency in the world, and they can seize your bank account, garnish your paycheck, close your business, and file criminal charges. Take control of your tax problems now by calling the experts at Tax Mediation Services and take advantage of the Fresh Start program and new laws that may allow us to negotiate a settlement for the lowest amount possible. Our team of tax attorneys and enrolled agents can stop collections and get you protected so you can take control of your financial future. Tax Mediation Services is accredited by the Better Business Bureau. Call now for a free case review and a price protection guaranteed quote.
Call Tax Mediation Services now at 800-610-9050. That's 800-610-9050. 800-610-9050.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
This is Slickery Trigger for Rebel Road Tactical. With proper care and feeding, your pistol will be ready when you need it, there to save your life. Shouldn't your gear be that good? Whether you need a holster for comfortable everyday carry or a tough-as-nails holster for your next training course, Rebel Road Tactical has what you need. Check us out on the web at rebelroadtactical.com.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 $3 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Is debt beating you down? You need discipline. You need the Debt Ninja. If you've been caught in a financial trap and need to be set free, then you need the Debt Ninja. Want to stop those harassing collection calls, start saving thousands in interest and fees, and get out of debt fast? Then you need to call the Debt Ninja. The Debt Ninja will find the best companies across the country that will help you consolidate all your bills into one easy payment, reduce your payments by 30 to 50%, and get you out of debt fast. If you have unsecured debt of $10,000 or more, such as credit cards, loans, or medical bills, call the Debt Ninja for a free 15-minute consultation.
Call 800-826-1246. 800-826-1246. That's 800-826-1246. Call today.
The Debt Ninja.
Ladies and gentlemen, he's a child of God, a husband, NRA conservative, radical right-wing supervillain, and Twitter rock star. American by birth, Texan by choice, and a badass by nature. He's the owner of TomOHalloran.com, OHalloranMedia.com, and PatriotRadio.net. Please welcome Tom O'Halloran.
And good morning, America. Welcome to the Patriot Radio Show. I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran, and I'm broadcasting today from my underground bunker deep in Arcantana, Brascarado. I'm here to educate, irritate, and agitate. And folks, I can pretty well guarantee you full agitation by the time the day is over. I've got a special show for you today. Last night was the VP, the Vice Presidential Debate. And my good friends Ken Crow and Jen Hamam, a.k.a. Ms. Mayhem, will be joining me in just a couple of minutes, and we're going to do a breakdown of the debate, who won, who lost, high points of the night, and so forth. So stick around. We've got a great, great show for you. Again, my name's Tom O'Halloran. My primary blog, TomOHalloran.com. You can find us on Facebook at Facebook.com/Patriot Radio Show. And folks, we do this show 5 days a week, so please tune in Monday through Thursday for this, the Patriot Radio Show. On Fridays, same bat time, same bat channel, we do Jihad on America. Here I cover the Islamists in America, sharing with you who they are, what they want, and why you should be very, very afraid. If you did not catch my show on the Muslim Brotherhood, my show Islam is Not a Religion, or my show on Islamophobia, then please do yourself a favor do me a favor. Heck, do America a favor. Find your way to PatriotRadioShow.com. Listen to all three of these shows, for they'll give you insight and perspective on the Islamic topic that you've probably not heard elsewhere. They'll also give you a solid foundation upon which we build each and every Friday as we continue pulling back the mask of Islam. I do the news about Islam around the world because it's a glimpse into the future of what's in store for us here in the homeland if we continue to allow the cancer of Islam to spread. This show is rebroadcast daily on ConfederateBroadcasting.com, ConservativeRadioNetwork.com, RedNationRising.us, and LibertyWorks Radio Network. You can also take the show on the road with you with your iPhone or Android by downloading the TuneIn app and doing a search for The Patriot Radio Show. And with that, we're going to go straight to the phone and see if my co-hosts are here. Ken, are you with me, brother?
Present accounted for, sir.
And Jen, are you with us?
I am here.
All right. Pretty much a draw last night, isn't it?
A draw?
A what? more like a butt kicking.
What are you smoking,
sir? Right? Well, I'll tell you what. The moderator was probably the fairest we've seen. Absolutely smoking hot. Just adorable young Filipina gal. But the least in control of any moderator yet. They just totally ignored her. They talked about what they wanted to talk about, when they wanted to talk, and talked over who they wanted. But let's take ladies first, because I'm a sexist SOB. Jen, what do you think was the high point of the debate?
Oh, there were so many.
Yes.
There were so many. When one of the points where I thought it was hilarious was when Pence shot back to Cain, oh, that's low. That's even low for you and Hillary or something
right,
like
right,
that.
Right, right, right.
That was really good, yeah. I love that part.
And if but, if you're going to read it, go ahead.
Pence was just very calm, cool, collected. You could tell Cain was red in the face. He was antsy. You know, he looked like a clown. He really did.
Yeah, he looked like and acted like a fifth grader is what it sounded. I thought he acted like a fifth grade girl. Sorry, pardon me, but I told you I was a sexist bastard. But very unprofessional.
No offense to my homosexual friends out there, but if this guy does not lean gay,
right,
my gaydar is really broken.
Right. Well, some of them married just to have a, what do they call it, a beard, just so they can look proper in public. But, it was pretty, pretty, shall we say, limp-wristed. Ken, what did you think? No, let me stay with Jen for just a second. You've got 10 points. Assign them. 6-4, 9-3. What do you, 9-3, yeah, that's a good math. How would you rate them by their performance?
Are you asking?
No,
me?
I'm staying with Jen on that one.
Oh, I'm sorry. How would I rate?
You got 10 points total.
See. I would say definitely 10, 7, Cain, 3.
Okay. And Ken, what was your favorite point of the evening?
The whole thing. what? And the reason I say that is not the reason you're thinking. I'm saying that because Pence, number one, set the stage for down the road. He sold America on the fact that he is in control.
Right.
He is very presidential, which was the main purpose of the debate, was to prove who can assume the office if, God forbid, need be. And he proved without a doubt he's a president. He's a president. And he could assume the duty at any moment, at any time, and be our president.
So what you're saying?
I think that was the biggest. That was the biggest selling point for me last night. It wasn't the issues. It was the fact that this guy is good.
The man, yeah.
He's
basically
grounded. He's got the gravitas.
He did what he was hired to do.
He almost left me with a thing. Is there any way we could flip this ticket?
Right.
Is there any way we could flip this ticket now?
Well,
you know, and I'm serious. I left thinking that, God, I wish he were on top of the ticket. But
how much do you think he will do for the evangelicals? Do you think he's going to bring them in closer? I think most of them were leaning our way anyway, but a lot of them may have stayed home. Do you think he did a good job in roping them in?
No question about it. He let his faith be known without pulling a Ted Cruz and reciting scripture all night. He didn't break out the Bible, but he let us know where he stood. I thought he was very effective at that. He was very effective on his recitation when the subject of abortion came up, and he even brought it up, actually.
Unapologetically
and that's
pro-life.
Something that's never been done.
Yeah.
And he laid the ground. I mean, he let everybody know, I'm a Christian, I'm a father, my faith is real. As a matter of fact, it's so real. Look what I'm getting ready to say, folks. And he said it, and the evangelical community nationwide was cheering.
Yep.
Whoever was watching cheered.
Yep. I think that's going to be a real solid bump for us in the next couple of days.
I don't know that the debate as a whole, and this is something you guys could discuss, I don't know that these VP debates really do that much in terms of moving the needle. But what it did do was cement, in my mind, in most people's minds, hey, Trump made a great choice.
Yeah.
Trump picked he made a great choice for me.
Well, I think it's been a long time since the VP debate has made a difference. I think it was back with, God, I'm drawing a blank on the name. Anyway, it was when Perot was running, it was the other guy asking, anyway, it's
who
been,
am I? Where am I?
Yeah, yeah.
Stockdale.
It's been a real long time since the VP debates have made a difference, but we've never had a general campaign like this. And I think that this debate will probably make more of a difference than just about any VP debate in history, because we've got the evangelicals standing off to the side in a very contentious debate or campaign. And I think now they're going to step in and embrace the candidate. And I think it's going to make a huge difference. We'll know when the polls start coming up over the next week.
Well, my thoughts, and get Jim's take on this, but my thoughts are he helped us in the Midwest. He helped cement because he presented himself as that typical Midwest grounded... I'm sorry, I'm outside with the dogs right now. He presented himself as that typical Midwest grounded good guy, the good guy image that we have of the Midwesterners. And I'm really hoping that plays well in places like Pennsylvania and Ohio and places like that, because we're going to need it in Pennsylvania. And I'm really hoping that he plays, because he's kind of a blue-collar guy. He's not your typical slick-talking politico-type person. He talks from the heart. He speaks from a clarity standpoint. He's very even-keeled, even-tempered.
And he let the insults just fly off. He addressed he picked a few battles last night. And he brought his own, but he swung at a couple of the things that Tim was throwing out there just to call him ridiculous.
He was a gentleman.
But
that's the word, that's the operative word that I should have used earlier. He was a gentleman.
But
and that's a big deal.
Yes. But unlike somebody, I won't mention his name, but his initials were DJT, he couldn't be baited. He fought the fights that he wanted to fight, but the rest of them, he just laughed them off and call them ridiculous, and I like that.
Well, there were some points in there, Tom, and again, get Jen's take on this in a minute. Jen, may you know, there were some times in that debate last night where he couldn't really respond. I mean, there was nothing you could say. Yeah, I love Donald. We all love Donald. But let's face it, Donald has said some things, done some things that Donald couldn't have said and done.
Yeah.
That's just reality, and they were indefensible. And what are you going to say if you're Ken?
I disagree, Ken. I don't think it was that he couldn't, that he didn't have anything to say. I think that he took the stance, I am not going to defend Donald Trump, because Donald Trump is his own man, and what he says, or what he has said in the past, he said, I am not here to defend Donald Trump. I'm here to talk about the vice presidential candidacy.
Well, that's a good take. I look at it a completely different way. I looked at it like, I'm not going to let you drive what I talk about. I'm here to talk about the issues. I'm not going to validate your claims, because amongst the few things that he said that Trump may have said, he threw out a lot of stuff that was never said by either party. He said that Pence said several things that he never said, and then he kept saying that Pence was refusing to defend Donald Trump. He never refused. We just didn't get around to talking about it. We had other issues to talk about. So,
right. And the issue of the taxes. Well, why won't he release the taxes? Nobody gives a shit about the taxes.
Five or six times that came up last night. Every time he got in trouble, he threw that out to try to change the topic.
Well, he even went so far as to say that Trump was, I guess for a lack of better words, anti-American and wouldn't support the military because he wouldn't release it. I'm still trying to figure out how the idiot managed to weave that.
That wasn't for not releasing it. You're anti-American, you're anti-military, you're anti-vets because you didn't pay.
Well, when they were talking about rebuilding the military, Tom,
right. But
he was saying Trump doesn't love the military because Trump won't release the taxes.
No, you misheard that. Okay, it's invalid either way. But he was saying, He won't build the military because he doesn't like the military, doesn't like the vets, because he won't pay tax, because he won't pay taxes. It wasn't the releasing. It's because you don't pay taxes. We need taxes to be paid to get these things done. Unfortunately, you can't just say you have to pay taxes. There are laws, and Donald Trump followed the laws, and he ended up not needing to pay taxes. And Hillary Clinton used the same exact tax code in 2014. And so did Tim Kaine. Tim Kaine used it in 1997. The same exact thing. The same exact code. As do almost every corporation. In fact, I mentioned the other day on the air, 10 of the largest corporations that paid absolutely no taxes, 10 of the top 10 are all huge Hillary supporters. So how much of a problem does she really have with not paying taxes?
But see, none of that is relevant if our side doesn't get that message out.
Right.
And that's been one of my chief problems with this campaign, as it is every election cycle.
Yeah, I was going
to say. With every Republican candidate, because our guys do not know how to get the damn message out.
Yep.
How do you get that message out? You know, come on, guys. Let's buy up $100 million worth of advertising and send that message to the American people.
Well,
nobody wants to talk about taxes.
They had a free stage. They've had a free stage for the last couple of weeks. Shame on them for not pointing it out during the debates. I mean, Donald Trump has mentioned it at a couple of rallies. I've paid all the taxes I'm legally required to pay. What more do you want?
I'm talking about hanging that around Hillary's neck.
Oh, yeah.
Top 10.
Yeah.
Now, these are Hillary supporters. Exxon, they don't pay taxes. Walmart, they don't pay taxes.
Right? GE. Yep, all of them. And 10 of the top 10 are huge, huge Hillary supporters. And this is why they're supporting her. Because she's
right,
all...
but they're not running for president, so she's not going to allow anybody to mention them.
Right, exactly.
That's my point. The Republicans need to be mentioning it. We need to be plastering that in the middle of every NFL football game. I mean, the baseball playoffs, everything. We need to be letting America know. And we're not.
Yeah. No, you're right.
That's my problem. You know, we have horrible messaging. We have the best programs for America. We have the best solutions for our issues. And we don't know how to sell it.
That's the problem. We have the best programs, and yet if you listen to the Dems, and if you listen to the public, they think the Republicans are the founders of the KKK. We're that bad at messaging. Folks, stick around. We got to take a quick break. Don't turn the radio down. Turn it up. Move closer. Listen in. These are very, very powerful messages. These would be the best political ads for Donald Trump ever. Stick around.
Somebody needs to send that message to Donald Trump.
I think you're right. I think you're right. I'm going to mute you now.
No, this is a great...
If I wanted America to fail, to follow, not lead, to suffer, not prosper, to despair, not dream, I'd start with energy. I'd cut off America's supply of cheap, abundant energy. I couldn't take it by force. So I'd make Americans feel guilty about using the energy that heats their homes, fuels their cars, runs their businesses, and powers their economy. I'd make cheap energy expensive, so that expensive energy would seem cheap. I would empower unelected bureaucrats to all but outlaw America's most abundant sources of energy. After banning its use in America, I'd make it illegal for American companies to ship it overseas. If I wanted America to fail, I'd use their schools to teach one generation of Americans that their factories and their cars will cause a new ice age. And I'd muster a straight face so I could teach the next generation that they're causing global warming. When it's cold out, I'd call it climate change instead. I'd imply that America's cities and factories could run on wind power and wishes. I'd teach children how to ignore the hypocrisy of condemning logging, mining, and farming while having roofs over their heads, heat in their homes, and food on their tables. I would never teach children that the free market is the only force in human history to uplift the poor, establish the middle class, and create lasting prosperity. Instead, I demonize prosperity itself so that they will not miss what they will never have. If I wanted America to fail, I would create countless new regulations and seldom cancel old ones that would be so complicated that only bureaucrats, lawyers, and lobbyists could understand them. That way, small businesses with big ideas wouldn't stand a chance. And I would never have to worry about another Thomas Edison, Henry Ford, or Steve Jobs. I would ridicule as flat earthers those who urge them to lower energy costs by increasing supply. And when the evangelists of common sense try to remind people about the laws of supply and demand, I'd enlist a sympathetic media to drown them out. If I wanted America to fail, I would empower unaccountable bureaucracy seated in a distant capital to bully Americans out of their dreams and their property rights. I'd send federal agents to raid guitar factories for using the wrong kind of wood. I'd force homeowners to tear down their own homes built on their own land. I'd make it almost impossible for farmers to farm, miners to mine, loggers to log, and builders to build. Because I don't believe in free markets, I'd invent false ones. I'd devise fictitious products like carbon credits and trade them in imaginary markets. I'd convince people that this would create jobs and be good for the economy. If I wanted America to fail, for every concern, I'd invent a crisis. And for every crisis, I'd invent the cause, like shutting down entire industries and killing tens of thousands of jobs in the name of saving spotted owls. And when everyone learned the stunning irony that the owls were victims of their larger cousins and not people, it would already be decades too late. If I wanted America to fail, I'd make it easier to stop commerce than to start it, easier to kill jobs than create them, more fashionable to resent success than to seek it. When industries seek to create jobs, I'd file lawsuits to stop them, and then I'd make taxpayers pay for my lawyers. If I wanted America to fail, I would transform the environmental agenda from a document of conservation
to an economic suicide pact. I would concede entire industries to our economic rivals by imposing regulations that cost trillions. I would celebrate those who preach environmental austerity in public while indulging a lavish lifestyle in private. I convince Americans that Europe has it right and that America has it wrong. If I wanted America to fail, I would prey on the goodness and the decency of ordinary Americans. I would only need to convince them that all of this is for the greater good. If I wanted America to fail, I suppose I wouldn't change a thing.
Tom O'Halloran, holding the line against tyranny from Washington, D.C.
Are back. It's the Patriot Radio Show on a Wednesday morning. Well, one button I forgot. Ken, are you still with me?
No.
All right. Folks, we're on the air with Ken Crow, Ken Crow and Jen Hayman. Ken, I've just got a contractor show up to my door 45 minutes early. I'm going to turn the helm over to you, let you and Jen talk about the debate for a few minutes, and I'll be right back, all right?
Okay.
All right. You guys are on.
Okay, Jen, what were your thoughts with the nearest I can identify Tim Kaine with? We're getting a lot of feedback. Oh, boy, this ain't going to work. See if it feeds back for you, Jen. But I was going to ask you, what are your thoughts on Kaine's general demeanor? I mean, for a guy that's running for president of the United States to act like the world's largest chihuahua was just blew me away. I mean, the guy has no class.
No, he didn't. He looked like a clown. He looked like, I don't know, I commented on it the whole time while Chuck was sitting here. I'm like, he looks like a clown. Number two, again, I apologize all of my gay friends out there, but he has a look that is so gay, like he's like almost an Elmer Fuddish. Just sort of do-do-do-do-do-do, you know, like he's just an ignorant doof.
Well, I listened to several interviews last night on the post-game show, if you will, and then early this morning. I was listening, and they interviewed quite a few people that were even conservatives on Fox and CNN, what have you, that knew Kaine personally. And they said, you know, that was not Tim Kaine last night. The Tim Kaine that I know was very gracious, very polite, very refined, very, you know, I mean, they had nothing but praises for the guy. They said, we don't know who this idiot was last night. And they were all saying the same thing. I mean, people that are politically opposed to him, but were friends with him, and they were saying the same thing. Who is this guy? This is not the Kaine that we know. And he's got to be fairly popular because he won big in Virginia for his governor seat and then became U.S. Senator, so Virginia likes him. Virginia is typically fairly conservative.
Actually, Virginia doesn't like him. Virginia doesn't like him at all. And the reason why, he won the one governor race but they wanted him out of the governorship here. So when he ran for Senate, it was a godsend. Because he was running Virginia into the ground. Oh, yeah, by the time he left, the state was incredibly in debt, and there was no reason for it. He raised taxes, and, oh, yeah, people didn't like him at all.
Well, okay, then, but again, I don't know. I'm parroting what these guys said last night. You know, that he was very popular. You know, I'm not saying he did a great job. I'm just saying he was popular enough to be elected to both of these seats. So he couldn't be a total bad guy, or Virginia wouldn't have elected him twice. And he won the lieutenant governor's race, too.
So, I think part of that was that his wife's father was a well-liked Republican governor.
Oh, really? Okay. Well, there you have it. But long story short, everybody's saying that they didn't recognize that Tim Kaine. And you could tell because something was wrong, because it didn't matter the subject. He had certain lines. He was going to get into that debate because his coaches and the Hillary team said, you have to say this. And you could tell that that's what was going on, because his responses and his interjections about whatever topic it was made no sense. You know, we're talking about the military. You're talking about taxes. You're throwing that talking point in. We're talking about, didn't matter, foreign policy. You're talking about him calling a woman a dog. You know what I mean? Am I making sense? You remember? He was all over the board.
Absolutely. He was like a jumping bean. If you watched his hands, he couldn't keep his hands still. He was like, you know, moving in the seat, squirming in the seat, like a kid who needed Ritalin.
Well, you could tell one of the things for the Democrats to be willing to do that and force him, this is a key point I was going to make, to force a guy that apparently is respected at many levels. I mean, the guy is a U.S. senator. To force him to impale himself on a sword to defend Hillary's policies in the manner that he did, to me, I'm going to be honest with you, Jen, that shows desperation on their parts. They're afraid. Now, whether or not they have a reason to be afraid is another topic, conversation, but they are afraid. Or they wouldn't have put this guy up to do what he did, because he made himself look fake. He basically destroyed his career last night. If Hillary doesn't win, I don't think he's seen in the Senate again after this. I think he's tossed out. I think he's done politically. Because what he did last night ruined him. That ruined anybody.
I think anybody who was on the fence and they saw his behavior last night and got to thinking, is if something happens to Hillary and we all know her health is failing, do we want this guy to assume the presidency of the United States? And the answer is a resounding no.
Right.
I mean, my God, the guy can't stand task. He's like a blubbering idiot.
Well, he made himself look foolish. That's the point I'm making. I think he's ruined.
Do you remember?
Oh, Tom's back.
Do you remember Humphrey Bogart in Kane Mutiny? He gets down to the end of the movie and he's sitting in the chair in court and he starts talking about the strawberries.
Yeah, but I don't remember what he said exactly.
It isn't so much what he said, it's the fact that he had become unhinged. And that's what Tim Kaine reminded me of last night. He kept going back to, where's the taxes? He won't release the taxes. We're already 10 subjects beyond that. But he kept throwing the taxes out to try to get Pence off topic of what he's hitting them with at that point.
Totally. Well, I think somebody told him, when you get stuck or if you get nervous, always just revert back to the taxes.
Yeah, and that was, I think, 5 or 6 times anyway. So it was a very surreal debate, to be sure.
Well, there's there's no question he became unhinged last night. I mean, there's no question about that. It might have been orchestrated unhinged, but because he was representing the Democrat Party last night. That was his job.
Yep.
He had two jobs going in. The number one job is do no damage. That's the number one objective of any vice presidential debate. Do no damage.
Yeah, he blew that
and
one.
And that's where Pence did a brilliant job. He didn't do any damage. If anything, he helped the cause. Then the second rule is show that you can become president if need be. Those are the two objectives of a vice presidential debate. Defend your party and their position and do no damage and show that you can assume the task if need be. And he failed miserably on both accounts, in my opinion. He really did.
Yep. Now let me ask you a question, Ken.
Yeah.
We don't know that the Trump campaign will get a bump out of this, but there's talk that it will, given the strange campaign that we not just on his side, but the campaign the race itself on both sides is stranger than we've ever had. If he gets just a 3-point bump out of this. Not much, a 3-point bump, which is doable after a debate. That puts Trump in a real good position just, 5-6 days from now going into the, because with a 3-point bump, all of the battleground states are now within the margin of error. And then if Trump comes in and does his best game, wow, it's huge.
And your question?
My question is, what do you think about the possibility of getting that? And it could be a real game changer with just a 2 or 3 point bump.
I can see with the dynamics of this election cycle being what they are that we've never seen anything like it before. Anything's possible. In this election cycle, we've seen that. We've seen the impossible become possible. We saw a guy overcome. I mean, everybody thought, well, that's it. Throw him to the ground, cover him up, he's done. And the guy rises to the top of the mountain and has a golden halo over him. We've seen that happen too. We've seen everything. So it's entirely likely that we probably do get a bump out of this. But I can tell you categorically, this election comes down to Sunday night. This election is going to be made or lost Sunday night that debate. And that's a fact, because if he doesn't do, everybody's going to tune in again to see. They're going to give him a second chance. They're going to give him another look on Sunday night. Well, okay, we got these topics on last debate. There'll be some new topics. Let's see what he says about these. And then we sort of have a wrap up for the third debate.
Yeah.
And if he does not prevail overwhelmingly Sunday night, and there's a couple of caveats to that statement, by the way. If he does not prevail overwhelmingly Sunday night, it's over. Because nobody's going to watch the third debate. They're going to have made their minds up from the first two debates, and it's a done deal. And we're going to know, we won't know the results till November the 9th. The morning, the wee hours, probably about 4 a.m. on November the 9th, we'll find out what happened. But that's where it's going to be. It's really won and lost Sunday night.
Yeah.
Trump really desperately needs to take some time off this week, and he needs to spend some time preparing with somebody other than Roger Ailes, who couldn't talk about anything but himself and his problems. He needs to prepare with somebody like Scott Walker, even Mike Pence, who knows how to debate and can help Trump learn how to pivot when Hillary brings something up, how to pivot away from it and bring it back to something that's positive from his perspective.
Well, Jan, you just touched on the big one. And, I mean, it's big. Let's face it. You just nailed it. His mistake in the last debate was, look, pal, we love you. You're a lot of fun to watch. We know you're a smart guy. We don't need to hear any more about your golf courses. We don't need to hear any more about your skyscrapers. We don't need to hear any more about how successful you are. We know all that. We've known it for 30 years, okay? We know who you are. We need to know now, what are you going to do specifically to fix this nation and the issues that we have? We don't need any more generics. We don't need any more Make America Great Again. All of that's wonderful, fluffy stuff. We want to know, what are you going to do? Give us some numbers. Give us some strategy. How are you going to rebuild this economy? You know, how are you going to rebuild these inner cities? Are you going to give tax abatements, 10-year tax abatements, federal tax abatements? If General Motors comes back to Flint, builds another factory, are they going to be tax-free for 10 years for creating 10,000 new jobs, UAW jobs? You know,
well,
this
let
is
me
the
tell
stuff
you,
he needs to talk about.
Let me tell you, Jake, I believe that he's planning all this stuff, but let me tell you why he doesn't talk about it. The reason he doesn't bring it up and he doesn't say it is because as soon as it leaves his mouth, Hillary and the Democrats are tearing it apart.
Sure.
So if they don't know what his plans are, they can't spend time tearing it apart. And that's frustrating the hell out of him.
Well, it's also going to cost him the election. Because people are asking these questions, what are you going to do, Trump? And I'm talking about the voter, the guys that pull the levers are asking these. I've been working the GOP office down here in Winterset, and I've been getting these people walking in. They love Trump. Give me a Trump sign. If you heard anything, what is he going to actually do? And everybody that walks in that office says the same thing. It's frustrating the voter, Jen, because they don't know what he's going to do.
Well, Ken, but he has put more details out than Hillary has. Okay? He's put more details on his immigration. He's put more details on his economic plan. He's put more details on just about everything except the tax side. But he's even got some details there. He doesn't have it down to the sub-paragraphs and the fine detail. But in the broad strokes, the voters have enough to have confidence that the guy is going to do the
job.
They?
Yes,
they do.
Do they?
Yes,
Ken, because they're coming in.
Wait a minute. Let's look at the polling. Do they really?
Ken, you know as well as I do, as frustrating as the polling is right now, you know as well as I do that it can be and is being tweaked. Forget the polling. Look at the lines. Donald Trump turned away at one event this last week. Donald Trump turned away 12,000 people. That's more people than Hillary has had in 12 events over the last month and a half. And since the beginning of August, she hasn't had 12,000 people all told at her events. Donald Trump gets that many people, 12, 15, 20,000 people, 3, 4, 5 times a week. Look at those numbers. Look at the social media numbers, the followers, the likes, the clicks, all that stuff. Donald Trump has this, and he has it by a mile. Stick around. We'll talk about it right from here when we get back from this. Another break. And my friends, once again, tune in, turn it up. Listen to this. One of the best political ads ever, if only they would run it. It's the Patriot Radio Show with Tom O'Halloran, Ken Crow, and Jen Heyman. We'll be right back.
If I wanted America to fail, to follow, not lead, to suffer, not prosper, to despair, not dream, I'd start with energy. And they did. the Keystone Pipeline, the war on coal, endless environmental lawsuits aimed at expanding federal power. They sure started with energy, but they didn't stop there.
I said this once or twice, but it bears repeating.
You can keep your plan if you are satisfied with it.
If you like your health care plan, you'll be able to keep your health care plan.
If you like your plan and you like your doctor, you won't have to do a thing. You keep your plan. You like your current insurance, you keep that insurance.
Period. Many Americans didn't get to keep their plan or their doctor. And as federal tentacles snake their way deeper into America's $2.5 trillion healthcare sector, many politicians voted to spare themselves the pain of their own policies. Policies they insisted would be good for the masses. Those politicians need a lesson in civics, because we are not the masses. In this country, we've never been, nor have we ever considered ourselves, the proletariat, the herd, or the hoi polloi, the mob, or the common folk, the rabble, or the riffraff. No, for 237 years, we, the American people, have not been subjects. We have been sovereign. We remain sovereign. And every 2 years on Election Day, we exercise our powers as sovereign. Our leaders in Washington would do well to remember that fact, particularly as they determine the power of federal bureaucracies. I make cheap energy expensive, so that expensive energy would seem cheap. You see, environmentalists don't use force. They don't need to. They don't even need lawmakers anymore. Instead, they use lawsuits to short-circuit the rule of law and expand bureaucratic control over things like residential wood burning, as in the kind that heats millions of homes in the winter. Many rural families may be forced to spend thousands to comply with new regulations if they can afford to comply at all. I would empower unelected bureaucrats to all but outlaw America's most abundant sources of energy. Welcome to Alabama, red state. For months, environmental interests have been waging a campaign here to kill coal. Of course, they can't say that to the conservative voters of Alabama. So instead, environmental front groups are pretending to care about the cost of electricity. It's a joke. And their money betrays their true intentions. New reports reveal that San Francisco-based environmental interests are funneling millions to the very Alabama front groups now seeking to hijack the state's Public Service Commission. Millions flowing from California to radical environmental groups in Alabama, all part of a backdoor effort to bring down the free market in the very heart of a conservative stronghold. Don't let them get away with it, Alabama. Whether they serve in Congress in Washington, work at a federal agency, or sit on the Public Service Commission in Alabama, our public officials were not empowered to negotiate the slow surrender of our freedoms. And the cause of energy independence is the cause of freedom. But not our children say that this cause was quietly forsaken by those who profess to lead it. Let not history say that we deserted our principles when they were most in need of a vigorous defense. Let it be said that we saw things clearly, even when it was difficult. That we stood up, spoke out, and fought back.
Attention patriots and conservative Americans. Have you ever wondered why the Tea Party did so well in 2010, but has not accomplished much since? Have you ever wondered where your money goes when you donate to these various national Tea Party groups, and then what do they do with it? The new blockbuster book, Ego in a Teabag, written by Ken Crow, an original Tea Party organizer and activist, is a tell-all about the seedy side of the Tea Party. Ego in a Teabag exposes the corruption, greed, and deceit behind this great American movement. Along with the exposing of the bat, the book also details how the Tea Party will become the most powerful political organization in America in the coming years. Order your copy today from Amazon.com to be released at the end of April. Just click on the picture of Ken's book on PatriotRadioShow.com and reserve your copy of Ego in a Teabag today.
O'Halloran. We'll put a boot in your ass. It's the American way. All brought to you courtesy of the red, white, and blue.
And we are back. It's the Patriot Radio Show on a Wednesday morning. We're on the air with my good friends Ken Crow and Jen Heyman. Guys, before we get back into the debate topic, why don't you both give up your websites and your Twitter and stuff again so everybody knows where to reach you. Ken, go ahead.
CrowsNestPolitics.com, plural, CrowsNestPolitics.com. Twitter is at KWR Crow for Kenneth William Robert Crow. No E on the end.
Oh, that's not Thank Kenneth you. Rodham Crow?
No, darned. It's not Kenneth Rodham Crow.
I'll be darned.
Nice try, Tom.
Jen, go ahead, dear. Give us your sites.
And mine is PassionatePackerterms.com, and Twitter is PassionatePackerterms.
Pretty easy, if you can spell.
Yeah, you got to know how to spell Packerterms.
Right? So you get, a lot of Republicans over there, but probably not a lot of liberals. They don't have the spelling chops. So let's see, where were we went to break? Anybody keeping score?
Jen and I, during the break, we're having a fight over Trump.
I'm okay. Here's how we'll settle it.
As
the moderator, as the moderator, I'll settle the fight. I'm with Jen.
Well, wait a minute.
Sight unseen. Go ahead.
Wait a minute. Jen and I both were together on this. We want to remind you. Be sure to get down to Carl's Jr.
Why is that?
Well, because that's where there's the meeting of the retired radio operators is today, apparently.
Did I have an open mic during that?
Yeah, you sure did.
Oh, geez. we have about there's probably 18 of us. A lot of them are retired police. We're all ham radio operators. And we eat lunch every single day somewhere in public. And it moves around. Mondays and Tuesdays, Thursdays and Fridays are pretty constant. We go to a rib place on Friday. We go to a Mexican place on Monday, an Italian place. But on Wednesdays, it's kind of a floater. And we move it from usually that one is fast food, so it'll be Popeyes or this or that or the other thing. And
today it's going to be Carl's Jr.
I guess it is. Today I won't be going. I didn't mean to leave that open, but it's a fun thing. I don't go but once or twice a week, but there's always a different mix of people because we're all older guys, so there are people off to the doctors and people not feeling well. But anywhere from 4 to 8 on a typical day, and sometimes 12, and sometimes 16 or 18.
I gotta pull a cane and jump in here and interrupt for a second. On Monday afternoons, I always go play cards with this group of 80-year-old Korean War vets.
Yep.
We play quarter poker, right? But it's gotten so damn depressing because every time I go, all I hear about is their latest, so-and-so just had his colon checked, and so-and-so's having prostate issues, and they complain because their wives want to make love and they can't anymore. It's like damn depressing. I'm sitting here going, this is what I have to look forward to.
Yeah, well,
my God.
I mentioned the other day that I just went on a diet on the 1st. I stepped on the scales at 240, and I do this about every 3 years. I hit 240, and then I take 30 days. There's no alcohol. I eat small portions. I cut out the pork and the bacon, most of the beef. I eat chicken and fish, a lot of spinach, drink a ton of water. And I can lose 30 pounds, sometimes 40 pounds in a month. And it takes about 3 years to put that back on. So it's just been a cycle I've been going through. This time the weight came back on in 2 years. Now that combined with the fact that my extra home activities, I've spent a lot of time down at the VFW with a lot of World War II vets. Same thing you deal with there. I spend a lot of time with these retired cops with the ham radio stuff. And it's like, these guys are all having issues. I'm a pretty damned healthy 63-year-old man. But I drink a lot.
Makes you afraid, doesn't it, Tom? Well,
no, not afraid, but cautious. And I'm a very healthy 63-year-old, but I've been drinking about 8 ounces of bourbon a night for decades. And I'm, you know, I usually put the bottle down for 30 days. And I don't have a problem putting it down. I drink a lot. I love the drink. But I don't have the addiction thing. I can put it down and walk away. You know, when my diet's over, when I hit my mark, I'm back on it. But this time I've decided I'm just going to stop drinking. I'm 63. The weight comes on faster. I'm more susceptible to getting health problems in the next 10, 15 years than I have in the past 63 years. So I'm off the alcohol and,
good for you.
And yeah, you know, it's not a fight. It's not a struggle. It's just something that I've enjoyed doing. I love my bourbon. I love my vodka, my tequila, anything off the top shelf. I'm in for it. But, yeah.
Well, I want to know how you lose 40 pounds in a month.
Well, I'm down 12 pounds since Saturday, since the 1st. We're on the 5th, and I'm down 12 pounds.
Okay, I'm going to officially call you a bitch then.
What's that?
I said I'm going to officially call you a bitch then.
It's real simple. This time I'm taking a little bit farther. I've never done the no sugars and no dairy. So this time I'm really hitting it hard. A lot of water. I'm drinking 12 bottles of water, 12, 16-ounce bottles of water a day. My meals are spinach, a lot of spinach, and most of my meals. Spinach, I'm eating tuna fish, the solid white chunk in water. It's the good stuff. Tuna with spinach is typically my lunch. On top of that, there'll be about a half of an avocado, some mandarin slices, some nuts, some flax seed, which I put on. It's a good fat. My dinner will be similar. I'll have chicken, rotisserie chicken, not Kentucky Fried Chicken, rotisserie chicken with a spinach salad. And then my lunch, I'll typically have celery sticks with natural peanut butter. That combined with a ton of water, no pork, no beef, no bacon, nothing that I really truly enjoy. and the pounds fall off. I get up in the morning and I'm 2 pounds less than I was the day before. And now this is going to go on for about another 5 days and I'll drop down to about a pound a day. But I can live with a pound a day as long as it's going off. Coming on, that's tough. But anyway, guys, we're down to the last couple of minutes. Why don't you each take a minute and a half and give us your thoughts on the debate and the process going forward, okay? And thanks for the ear on the diet thing. I'll keep you posted.
Well, I think that unlike Ken, that Trump is on his way. I do not believe that Hillary is going to lose this election. I will not allow that thought even creep into my head.
So for Hillary to lose, you mean
cannot happen.
You mean for Hillary to win?
Correct. That's what I said.
No, but go ahead.
Okay.
Sorry to confuse you, but that came across wrong.
Trump cannot lose this election. It has to be him who wins. Again, you know, I point to exactly what you said, Tom. Look at the numbers, the people that he's turning away, the numbers he's getting in growth, and those crowds are only growing. I think on Sunday, he is, as long as he prepares, and I can't stress this enough, he needs to take the next couple days, take it off, find someone to help him prepare, or a team to help him prepare, teach him how to pivot. When Hillary brings this crap up, how to pivot back to a positive thing for his part, he needs to learn how to deal with Hillary, because we cannot have another debate like this last one. That was a disaster. And it was a disaster because he failed to prepare. He thought he knew it all. He didn't have to prepare and everything would be just fine. And that's not the case with her. You know, he needs to hit her. He needs to slam her hard. He needs to have her spinning in every which direction while he's giving her the next way to spin in a different direction. And, you know, let her health issues just unfold right there in front of the entire country on TV. And you know they will.
Yeah.
If he does not do that, he is going to be in major trouble. And what Ken and I were just talking about on the phone was his problem with women. He does have a problem with women. And I, as much as I like Trump...
We all have problems with women.
I have posted this on his website page, and I have told him, you know, he has an issue with overweight women. It's like I don't know, it's just like a thing with him. He won't be seen with overweight women. He doesn't respect overweight women. He doesn't think that they have any value. And that has been true for a long time. If you watch any of the films or any of the things of his rallies or anything like that, he never has an overweight woman anywhere around him.
Yeah.
And that's a problem because the average woman in the United States is a size 16.
Yeah.
And part of his beauty and need for women to be perfect size, you know, a perfect size 3 and everything. Well, every woman is not like that.
Right.
And he needs to get over his bad self where that's concerned.
Exactly. All right. Ken, we're down to 1 minute, brother.
Okay. Number one, the Sunday night debate's going to be make it or break it for Trump. That's a fact. You guys can disagree, fight with me all you want to, but it'll be... If he wins Sunday night convincingly, we got a good shot at this. If he doesn't, it's over.
I'm hurt that you. I'm hurt
to,
that you would think that Jen and I would disagree with you on anything.
I understand. It's going to come down. It's beginning to look like it's coming down to Pennsylvania, boys and girls. And right now, he is behind in Pennsylvania. Now, can Pence help him in Pennsylvania? Possibly. But he's going to have to get contrite. He's going to have to appeal to the women. He needs to come out with an advertisement that says, I apologize. Some type of mea culpa on his verbal treatment of women over the years. He needs to come out with something. And it needs to be contrite. It needs to be apologetic. He needs to do this. And if he doesn't, and lastly, he needs to get off Twitter. Stay off Twitter.
Yeah,
amen.
But that's not going to happen, so let's just pray for him. All right,
well,
folks.
Kellyanne was last night. She was at the debate and didn't have his phone, and you saw what happened.
Yep.
Go ahead.
We've hit a hard spot. Guys, thanks for coming in and doing this with me today. I appreciate both of you. Tune in tomorrow for another episode of the Patriot Radio Show with my good friend, Bill Perriman. This has been the Patriot Radio Show with Tom O'Halloran, Ken Crow, and Jen Hamam. God bless you and yours, America. We're out of here.
Yeah. Hey, Jen. Yeah.